All in Drug Treatment Centers, and I will be the moderator for today's one-hour training.
As we get started,
I'd like to note that there are two options for listening to the audio portion of the webinar. You can listen through your computer by simply turning the volume on, or you can call in and listen over the phone using the toll-free number that is listed on your screen in green. On behalf of Gateway Alcohol and Drug Treatment, I'd like to welcome you to our Opioid Overdose Averted, Naloxone Friendly Zone Save Lives webinar. For those of you who may not be familiar with Gateway, we are the largest provider of substance abuse treatment services in Illinois. We have 10 locations throughout the state and provide individualized treatment plans for both adults and adolescents. We offer outpatient, day treatment, residential, and aftercare services. Outpatient services are available at 7 locations, including River North, Pekin, and Swansea, and residential services are available at 6 of our locations. For more information about Gateway Treatment Programs, you can contact us at our HOPE line at 877-971-HOPE, or you can also visit us on the web at www.recovergateway.org.
We need to briefly run through a few housekeeping items.
First, a quick review of how to communicate with the presenter. As you can see here, the controls appear on the left side of your screen. In the controls area, you will see a box with a smiley face in it. If you click on the down arrow, it will open your communication options. At certain points throughout the presentation, you may be asked to participate, and you can do so by accessing this drop-down menu. Options that you should see available in your drop-down are raise your hand, agree, disagree, and ask for assistance.
If you'd like to ask a question,
you can do so in the communication box at the bottom of the control area. Technical questions will be answered during the webinar, and topic-related questions will be addressed following the presentation. You may also download a copy of today's presentation by clicking the blue download button in the shared file section. And don't worry if you are unable to print the presentation at this time. You will be receiving an email at a later date that will include a link to today's presentation.
Today's webinar will
be conducted in listen-only mode to minimize any distractions or background noise. So we need to take just a moment and confirm the audio is working. Would everyone please raise your hand if you can hear me by clicking on the hand icon on the webinar toolbar? And we'll give everyone a minute to find that option. Okay, very good. Once again, we have a big group today. So the duration of today's webinar is 1 hour. So all the course material will be covered by shortly after 1:30. There will also be a question and answer session after the presentation, during which time our trainer, Carl Scroggins, will answer questions submitted by participants. As I mentioned a moment ago, you can submit a question at any time during today's training by typing your question in the chat box located in the bottom left corner of your screen. And finally, a quick note for those of you looking to receive a CEU for today's presentation. In order to receive one CEU, you must access the webinar for 1 hour or more today. And this is a very important note. If you have a group of people in the room, only the person who registered and logged into today's presentation will be provided the CEU. And the CEU certificates will be delivered within 3 weeks of today's presentation. At this time, I'd like to introduce your trainer, Mr. Carl Scroggins. With more than 24 years of industry know-how, including counseling clients and supervising programs, Carl is responsible for leading Gateway's life-saving opioid overdose prevention initiatives. During his tenure at Gateway, Carl has developed several trainings on a variety of topics designed to enhance the knowledge of Gateway's clinical professionals, including co-occurring disorders, enhancing counseling skills, and teamwork development. Carl holds an AAS degree in mental health, alcohol, and other drug abuse counseling from Harold Washington College in Chicago. Now I'll turn the presentation over to your trainer, Mr. Carl Scroggins. We hope you enjoy the presentation. Carl?
Thank you, Matt. Hello, this is Carl Scroggins. I'll be, as Matt said, your presenter for today. And we're going to be going over opioid overdose and management. Hopefully by the end of the presentation, you'll have an idea if you choose to set up an own program, maybe in your treatment center, or to seek training yourself at in various states where they are allowed to do that. We're going to talk about what opioids are, how they affect the body, what an overdose is again. And right now, I'd like to check something out here for everyone listening. You've probably heard there's two ways to call this, opioids and opiates. I'm going to give you a minute, and then I'll tell you the difference between opioids and opiates. But think for a moment, and then if you've guessed correctly which one of these is synthetic and which is natural, raise your hand. So I'll give you a minute to do that. All right. If you got it right, opioids are synthetic, which means that man has changed the chemical structure, and opiates are natural, like heroin. How many of you got that correct? If you can raise your hand, and I'll take a look at that. All right. Now, and what I'd like you to do now, before I switch to it, is how many, and I'm going to use the term opioids throughout the training to also include opiates. How many opioids can you name? How many do you know? And in the next slide, we'll look at how many there are. And raise your hand if you think you've got the majority of them. So I'll give you just a minute and think that through. And all right, let's take a look. These are some of the most common ones: heroin, morphine, codeine, methadone, Demerol, oxycodone, oxycontin, hydrocodone, fentanyl, and hydromorphone. Of all of these, fentanyl is the most, the strongest of all the opioids. Heroin is one of the most commonly abused. How many of you got most of these? Raise your hand if you got most of them. All right, looks good. Let's move on then. And talk about what they have, the effect of opiates and opioids. You know that they affect breathing, and as we go along, we'll talk about that in more detail. What is an overdose? That's the big thing that's happening these days. It's the ingestion of a legal or illegal substance in more than the usual dose, either on purpose or unintentionally. Ingestion means taking it in by a variety of means. Sniffing, snorting, smoking, swallowing pills. We're going to go into that in more detail later, and also legal and illegal substances. Now, I ask another question. Is there a difference between a legal or illegal substance when you're taking it? Think for a moment. Is there a difference? And in some ways, no, there isn't. An opiate, if it's a pure opiate or opioid, will have the same effect. Unfortunately, drug dealers are not very ethical, and they frequently cut their heroin with other drugs, which either makes them more powerful by adding fentanyl, or they might cut it with another substance, which makes it least or less effective. This is dangerous for overdose because if a person changes drug dealers, if they're using heroin, this can cause them to overdose because they're using the same amount they have in the past, but now it's something stronger. We'll look at this next one, the heroin problem in Illinois. I'm going to talk about specifically at the moment. Overdose death has really spiked since 2007. In 2010, as you look at the slide, you'll see that Chicago had 24,360 admissions for heroin-related problems, and New York came in second at 12,000. I'm not sure if this means that in Chicago where they're just not as experienced and successful at using, or there's actually a greater problem here. Many of the statistics I look at do show, though, that Chicago probably has one of the largest overdose and opiate problems in the country. Illinois is one of 16 states that has a higher car accident fatality rate than the rate of people who overdose, rather. People who overdose have a higher rate of death, so that's a lot. And the statistics you'll see, they actually have increased, where we have 2006 to 2008, Will and McHenry County's got a 100% increase. We're actually seeing it around even more, up to 200% now, and through many more counties in the state. And of course, this is true throughout the country. If you research that, every state is experiencing an increased use of opioids. Many states now have changed their laws so that a certain drug can be used, naloxone, which reverses opiate overdose. And what this does is it allows limited immunity to people if they call in and say that someone's overdosing. When the police get there, as long as they don't have huge amounts of drugs or they're not dealing, they won't be prosecuted. In the past, this prevented people from calling for help. Also, if a person is trained and they use naloxone, they're protected by a Good Samaritan law, which prevents them from being prosecuted for using it. I'm going to move to the next slide here. Here are the states that have passed laws that are similar, Good Samaritan drug use laws, that allow the use of naloxone and limited immunity to those who call for help. So you can see that many states are coming online now and recognizing this as a problem and allowing people to use naloxone without fear of prosecution. If you look at the bottom and you want to see a complete list of state laws, you'll see the Network for Public Health Law, August 2014. Just type that into Google and it'll bring you to that site and allow you to see the rules and laws for your state. What does opioid overdose do to the body? If anyone here has seen the movie Pulp Fiction, would you please raise your hand? All right. If you'll remember in that movie, they show someone being rescued from an overdose by plunging the needle into their chest. Well, I have to tell you, that's just drama. They did that for effect. In reality, you either inject it into a muscle or give it IV or a missile. It's not as dramatic as it shows on the television. So when we train people, it takes away the fear when you let them know that you don't have to ram a needle into someone's chest. Opioids suppress breathing. That's their big problem. There's a part of the brain, at the brainstem, called the medulla, and a huge amount of opioids, or a lesser amount depending on your tolerance, will cause the people to fall asleep and then stop breathing, because the part of the brain that manages that automatically is now suppressed. So that's the big thing we want to reverse with naloxone. Naloxone is called an antagonist, and basically what it does is it kicks off the opioids from the site of the reception in the brain and takes its place, but it doesn't cause the same action as the opioids, so therefore your breathing can return. I have a slide here showing the progression. When people take an opioid, their breathing does slow down. Then eventually the breathing stops, the heart stops, and then brain damage begins. So I'm going to let you think for a moment and think, how many minutes would it take for brain damage to begin when a person stops breathing? I'll give you a few moments to raise your hand and see how many of you get this correct. All right. It would take 6 minutes is the usual length of time for brain damage to begin. If you got that right, I should see your hand up there on the side. And of course, we don't want that to happen, so we have a drug now that can reverse that. Before I go on with more explanation, I'm just going to test your knowledge here. And in this poll, it says, what can increase your risk of overdose? Please read it, and then you'll see a screen pop up to where you can make a choice, and we'll see how many of you get the right answer. Oh, very good. The majority of people picked the correct answer of all of the above. That's excellent. So we have a well-educated group here. That makes this a lot easier. We're going to look at what the risks are for overdose. You'll see at the top and left, it says substances. And as you saw when you just asked, that we're asked this question, you know that mixing drugs does cause a greater problem. One of the two things you'll need to know on this is the word synergistic and additive. When you add, let's say, heroin and benzodiazepine, you have a synergistic effect. And that means that 1 and 1 equals 4 instead of equaling 2. Additive effect would be 1 and 1 equal, obviously, 2. Additive would be like having one drink of alcohol and then another one. When you mix drugs, though, you have a higher risk of synergistic effect, which means higher risk for people, the medulla being infected and inhibiting breathing. And, of course, how much the person takes and the potency of it. As I mentioned earlier, you know that drug dealers are not very ethical, so they're frequently cutting their product so they can make more profit. So a person oftentimes doesn't know what they're actually getting. There's been many, as I mentioned before, overdoses where they've mixed fentanyl, which is powerful, with heroin, and people die from this. We look at individual characteristics, age. The older you are, the less your liver is able to metabolize many of the drugs that you take in your body. And the liver is the main organ which metabolizes drugs and other things that we take in. And sometimes it's damaged by doing this. There's also tolerance. If you use drugs over a period of time, you have an increased tolerance. There's also a danger with people who leave treatment or hospitals and their tolerance is reduced. They don't realize that they use their normal amount and they overdose. Once again, health status, their liver, genetic factors, how their body metabolizes. There's another category where they're not sure. And of course, that they're taking other medications. If a person has HIV and they're on protease inhibitors, it infects the level of opioids in their body. Excuse me. That includes methadone and other opiates and opioids. The route, and I mentioned I would discuss this more detail. Look at the top list there and look at injection, inhalation, ingestion, snorting, and inserting. And pick which one do you think gets the drug into the body the most rapidly. So I'll give you a minute to think about this, and then I'm going to give you the answer. And if you got it right, raise your hand. The drug, the method that gets it into your body most rapidly is called inhalation. So if you smoke it, that's going to get into your body in much higher concentrations and more rapidly because of the surface area of your lungs. The next one would be injection, and then snorting, and thirding, and actually last is ingestion. And that would create overdose risk. Remember, overdose is not like in the movies where it happens right away, although that is possible. An overdose can take from several minutes to up to 3 hours. So that's something to remember. Somebody could come into your waiting room if you're in a treatment center. They might have swallowed a handful of opioids, and the overdose may not kick in until they're there for an hour or more. So that's why it's important to have a program in place where you can manage overdose. It's also good to be able to recognize the difference between a depressant overdose and a stimulant overdose. When you're dealing with a depressant overdose, then you can see the list up here, alcohol, GHB, benzodiazepines, like Valium or Xanax, and of the opioids, like morphine, dilaudid, heroin, or methadone. You're going to see that they have difficulty staying awake, problems walking, they may have slurred speech or even have difficulty talking at all. Their pulse may be much slower than normal. They may have slow or absent breathing. Normal breath rate, as you can see up there, is between 10 and 20 breaths per minute. If it's getting down to 7, 6, or less, the person may actually require breathing assistance from you. We'll talk about how to do that more a little bit later. So you're going to also look for their skin looking pale or blue. The medical word for blue is called cyanotic or cyanosis. And if someone has a dark complexion, you can look at their nail beds and look for to see if they're blue. That'll give you an idea whether or not they're getting enough oxygen. What do you think their eyes will look like? Pinpoint. A lot of times when I do this training, people point out they think that the pupils would be large, but that's actually the muscle contracting. And since opiates cause it to relax, you'll see that the pupils are more pinpoint. people who are beginning to use opiates or overdose will often vomit. When you're dealing with an overdose, the people are not going to respond well to external stimulus such as running hand over the sternum or above the lip or pitching behind the arm. If they're not responding, that's something that something serious, and so you need to suspect a present overdose. Now, stimulants obviously are different. You can see the list of them up there: cocaine, crack, Ritalin, which is often used for attention deficit disorder, methamphetamines, and ecstasy. You're going to see a fast pulse or no pulse because it's caused the heart to stop. Shortness of breath. They're going to be hot and sweaty. Remember, their bodies are, it's called sometimes amped up. They may be confusion, possible hallucinations, visual or auditory. They even, in some cases, go unconscious. Their muscles are tight, so they're going to have a clenched jaw, seizures, vomiting. They may have problems talking or walking because their muscles are contracting. If they are able to, it's going to be rigid or jerking limbs. There's really not a lot you can do for stimulant overdose, but call 911 and put them in an environment that has low stimulation, quiet and dark, and this will help manage them until people, you can get assistance from 911. I'm going to go over overdose risk factors again. One of them is reduced tolerance. I have a question again for your raising your hand. When is overdose most likely to occur? When people are leaving hospitals, prisons, or treatment? What's the time frame? I'll give you a minute, and if you get it right, please raise your hand. Okay, the average length of time for an overdose to occur is 2 weeks after they leave prison, jail, treatment, or hospitals. Overdose also is increased by the route, and I told you that injection and inhalation are the fastest ways to do it. If they're ill, impossible liver damage, and then depression. What if they've come in to your treatment facility, they may not have followed through on recommendations, and they leave, they may not have housing, they may not have the coping skills that they need, and of course if they're addicted, they're going to go back to their drug of abuse. Using alone. A lot of times, if they've gone through treatment, they may feel embarrassed because they've relapsed, and so they're going to use alone, and this also increases the risk of overdose because there'll be no one there to see this or save them. Mixing drugs, we talked about synergistic and additive effects, and of course, changing the drug supply. If you're going to a new dealer or you're in a new neighborhood, you don't know what you're getting. And of course, the health status of your liver. And we mentioned that your liver metabolizes everything you take into your body. If they've had a history of overdose, they're more likely to do it again. There was a client who overdosed 5 times, and the 5th time he would have died except that he overdosed along a running path. A nurse found him. He was blue, and she saved him. When he came into treatment, we gave him all kinds of information on what to do in case he were to overdose again. The research that I've looked at shows that this does not encourage overdose, but it does reduce the risk of people overdosing if they have this information. So we need to let them know all the risk factors that would increase the risk of them overdosing. We just went over this, the period of time or in the hospital, mixing drugs and using alone are all the things I'd like to emphasize that we need to educate clients on before they leave our care. What does an opioid overdose look like? We talked earlier, problems with breathing. It may be slow or shallow, remember. If it's below 10 or it gets to really 6 or 7, you're going to have to probably do rescue breathing. If they pass out, throwing up, again, remember to look for a bluish tint to the face, lips, or fingernails. Loose muscles, cold or clammy skin. A lot of times, too, you'll see someone who appears to be asleep, but their breathing is very labored and gurgling. And if you're taking care of people in an inpatient facility and you hear this, you need to suspect it may be an overdose. If you go and wake them up and you find out that they're just sleeping and they normally snore like that, better to have them irritated than for you to walk by later and find out that they've died from an overdose. Sometimes they may be awake, but they're unable to talk. They're limp, and again, their face is very pale. You can see a picture here. This is what the blue looks like. Emphasizing this process so you can be able to recognize overdose and then manage it. If they're overdosing, painful stimulus, the sternal rub. You can also take your knuckle and rub it above their lip or pinch behind their arm. If you've ever got a pinch behind your arm, you realize that hurts. If someone doesn't respond to that, you know you've got a problem and you need to start calling out for people to call 911. And if you have an overdose kit available for them to come with it when there's an emergency call. When you come to the person, one of the first things you want to do if they're having difficulty breathing or they don't appear to be breathing, check for breathing. Make sure their airway is clear. If you see something in their mouth, if it's easy for you to reach in and take it out, go ahead and do that. But don't do what's called a clean sweep or a blind sweep. Otherwise, you could push it down into their throat. Make sure an ambulance is called right away. And if you have a medical department, you may want to contact them. And you should stay with them until help arrives. You should never relinquish control of your client or patient unless it's to someone else of equal or greater training than yourself. Let's move on. This is what a sternal rub looks like. You notice the person's wearing a glove. In many of the kits that you can put together for this, it's recommended you use gloves and follow what are called universal precautions and feel that all body fluids may be at risk for infection. If you can't rouse them, call an ambulance. One of the things, if you look to the side, and this will help you put a structure to everything I'm talking about, on the side there where it says shared files, you'll see Naloxone Save Me. This is a protocol you can use and memorize so that you know exactly what to do if you come across someone with a suspected overdose. Back to the slide. Have someone call the medical department. Check again the airway, make sure it's not blocked, and you're going to check their breathing. Put your ear down to their face and listen and watch for their chest rising and falling. If a person has no pulse, you're going to just go straight to CPR. So one of the things that's recommended, anyone who's trained in overdose management, that they're up to date in their CPR training. If they aren't breathing, begin basic life support. If they are breathing, put them in the recovery position. And that means turning them on their side in a lateral position so that in case they throw up or something happens to block their breathing, that you have an open pathway for them to get some air in. Either get this naloxone kit yourself or so you can administer the naloxone, or if there's someone else there, have them go and get the kit. Once again, if you are able to, download and print out the Save Me PDF, and you can follow along with me. And again, things to take into consideration are as if they've overdosed before. In the Save Me protocol, I'm going to go over it right now just so you can take notes. I'm going to cover it again at the end of the seminar. The S stands for stimulate. So what you're going to do is use painful stimulus to see if you can wake them up. If you can't wake them or they seem very lethargic, you can call 911. If they are breathing and you have to leave them, put them in the recovery position. If you call, tell the operator that you're dealing with a person who's not breathing or barely breathing and not responsive, so that they'll send help right away. You're immediately going to check the airway, make sure there's nothing in there, and as I mentioned before, if you're able to see it and you can reach in and grab it, go ahead. You may want to have them on their side when you do this in case it should fall back into their throat. If their breathing is below 6 or 7, you may want to give some rescue breaths, and you're going to use a mask to do this, and I'm going to show you a picture of a type of mask you can use. It's very important to have a barrier between you and the other person when you're giving breaths. I worked in a hospital emergency room, and I was helping with a person who had been shot in the back. And I was doing the chest compressions, and the nurse, this was back in the 80s, was doing the breathing. And as we were doing this, the man threw up in her mouth. And this was something that just shocked me. She just turned her head, spit it out, cleared out his mouth, and went right back to rescue breathing, because at that time we didn't use barrier methods. That would have been very difficult for me to handle if he'd be thrown up into my mouth. Another way that you can also help with an overdose, if the person tells you that they've overdosed but they're still able to talk, and then they show symptoms and they ask for naloxone, it's okay for you to give it to them. Naloxone will not harm you. And if you're not taking opiates, it'll have no effect on you at all. The only thing with naloxone is that it can throw you immediately into withdrawal, and sometimes people can get really irritated and they may throw up. It's going to make them feel pretty awful. So you're going to have to be educated on letting them know they're not always going to feel this way. I'm going to warn naloxone in just a moment. If you come upon someone and you see them going into a state of becoming unresponsive, and the people around them said, you know, I saw them take something, you can also administer naloxone during that time as well. Or if a family member or other staff tell you and they see overdose symptoms. You'll see here I have listed how to do rescue breathing. First thing you're going to do is tilt the person's head back and lift their chin up and pinch their nose. By tilting their head back, you're opening the airway. Now, if you've seen them fall and you suspect a neck injury, you can look this up, but your goal will be to pull their chin up and not tilt their head all the way back so that you don't injure their neck any further. You're going to give 2 slow breaths into the mouth, and do it slowly, and then let the chest relax. Because if you do it too rapidly, you're going to cause air to go into the stomach and it could cause them to throw up. You're going to check for a pulse about every minute or so. And look at this formula here. You're going to write this down somewhere, the number 1 and 5 and 12. This is a formula to remember. If someone isn't breathing enough or not breathing at all and they do have a pulse, you're going to give 1 breath every 5 seconds for 12 breaths, and then you're going to reevaluate them. And then keep doing that until you see them breathing on their own and at a proper rate. So you're going to basically be rechecking their pulse about every minute along with their respiration. You can see here's the mask that you can order. They're very inexpensive. And this should be in every overdose kit if this is a program you're going to establish. Or if you're going to go get trained yourself and your state allows it, you probably should have a kit in your home so that in case there's an overdose that occurs. This shows you how to put someone into the recovery position. And if you notice, it has them on their side, and their arm here is preventing them from falling over and blocking their face or their bodies from blocking their chest from rising and falling. And again, this helps them if they should throw up or somehow get something caught in their throat. This is a full description of how to do that, so that when we're offline, you can go over the training, and it shows you how to put someone in the recovery position and do it safely. You don't want to injure someone by doing this. I'm going to go into detail now about naloxone. As I told you, it's an antagonist, which means it throws off the opiate or opioid, takes its place, but it doesn't stimulate the nerve and the neural button, as where it's at, as much as the opiates do. So it doesn't affect them, their mood. It's a drug that can't be abused, and it will restore their breathing and consciousness. It can be given as a shot or as a nasal spray. It's most often given the paramedics come, they'll give it IV. And that's one of the quickest ways to get it into them. It's been used for like 30 or 40 years now. Minimal side effects. Rarely do people have an allergic reaction to this. One thing you really need to know, though, is that naloxone has no effect on these drugs that you see listed here. So all of these drugs are drugs that are commonly abused or also taken for healthcare reasons. Tricyclics, as you see there, used to be an old antidepressant. They can now use amitriptyline, which is a tricyclic, for helping people to sleep or for neuropathy, which means pain from nerve damage. Xanax and Valium are benzodiazepines. Alcohol, you know, is a depressant. And so remember, synergistic and additive. Most of these, if they're depressants, will be synergistic. So any of the downer drugs like Valium, Xanax, DHB, ketamine can be synergistic with opioids. Remember, though, if they are taking two drugs, that even if you know that they are on another drug besides an opioid, you can still use it to at least counteract the effects of the opioid and maybe return breathing to close to a normal rate. Remember, if you suspect overdose, go ahead and use naloxone. Remember, it can't hurt anyone. If there is no overdose, it's not going to do anything to them. Just as a side note for people, there actually is a reversal drug for benzodiazepines. It's called flumazenil, F-L-U-M-A-Z-E-N-I-L. Not frequently used, but it's of interest probably for you to know that it does exist. There are different modes of administration. If you look at the top up here, you'll see Envisio just came out recently. And it's an intramuscular injection where it injects naloxone right into the muscle. And this actually talks to you and guides you through the process of giving naloxone. The problem with this is it costs several hundred dollars for just one of these. So you'd have to have a lot of money. Some counties are using it, but most are not. They're using the injection method that you see here, which is only $30 to $40. And this is where you pull it up into a syringe and you inject into a muscle. So that's what most people are being trained on right now. The Chicago Recovery Alliance trains people on this method. And the Chicago Recovery Alliance was one of the first groups in the country to begin using naloxone. They began using it as far back as 2001. You'll see some links to it at the end of the presentation, and that'll give you a lot of information on what to do if you want to set up your own program. What we use here at Gateway is the nasal mist method. It comes as pre-filled vials with the syringe and nasal cones, so you can make a kit like that. Remember, naloxone has to be stored away from light. It usually lasts about a year, depending on where you order it. And when you use naloxone, you always have to look to see if on the vial itself that it's not out of date. Naloxone does lose its potency after its expiration date. You can see here that you spray it into the nostril, 1 milliliter into each nostril, and what this does is it absorbs directly through the mucosal membrane. And so the person, as long as their heart's beating, this will work. It's not absorbed in the lungs. It's absorbed here in the mucosal area. And that allows it to begin working in 3 to 5 minutes. You can administer a dose, and if the first dose doesn't work in about 3 to 5 minutes, you can administer it again to see if there's an effect. If there is no effect, there may be another reason why this person is not responding, and of course, you've called 911 by now. You can see here in the slide that it's a fine mist that this sprays. You should never put naloxone directly into someone's nose. You need to mist it so that it absorbs, and you cover more surface area. If a person's one of their nostrils is damaged, you can squirt it all into one. It's not ideal. But of course, you want to rescue this person and it still has an effect. Now, here's another one, another quiz that you can take here. Please read this and then answer which one you think is correct, and that'll give you the answer. All right. It appears that everyone has voted, and most of you got it correct. Very good. You spray 1 milliliter into each nostril. are basically half of the vial into each nostril. Excellent. You guys did really well. This is what, if you order naloxone, this is what the packaging looks like. You're going to be administering 2 milligrams or 2 milliliters into each nostril. And then if that doesn't work, once again, you can give a second dose. I'm going to shift over here. You can buy pre-made kits that have all of this in them. They'll have one vial of a pre-filled syringe. It has a lure lock on it, which you screw in what's called the mucosal atomizer device or MAD device. And they usually come with a pair of gloves. A lot of them come in a zipper plastic bag. And you should in there, they don't provide this, but you should have a quick use guide in the kit itself for overdose to manage it. We've discovered you don't want it too complicated, so you might just have the Save Me protocol sheet in there and maybe some other information. And in an emergency, information needs to be clear and simple. You'll have we have the Save Me protocol in ours. Remember, S stands for stimulation, call 911. A is airway. V is ventilate if they need it. E, you evaluate. If they're not better, you're going to prepare and give them the naloxone. And, of course, you spray 1 milliliter into each nostril, which equals 2 milligrams of naloxone. And then reevaluate after every minute or so. And if they need breathing, you reevaluate after one breath every 5 seconds for 12 breaths. And you evaluate their pulse and their breathing. And then you need to fill out, most states require you fill out a form that you've administered naloxone, and then report back to them. This is what one of the common kits you can get, and this is what it looks like. The only thing that's not in there is the breathing mask, and you have to have that separately. This is what you'll find in the kit. This will be packaged separately in its own little package, and both of these will be inside of this package. And you just quickly put this together. It's very easy. And one of the things you can do is go online and just type in naloxone trainer. And in Google, it'll bring you to a site that actually has trainers where you use water. So if you're going to be someone who trains people after you've gone through a trainer's program, you'll allow them to have actual hands-on experience with using the nasal mist version. This is what's in our kits and what's most commonly in a kit. If you notice, it includes the MAD device and the vial of liquid and the breathing mask and a pair of gloves for universal precaution. Another photograph just to give you an idea of what this looks like. On the back of the box, it shows how to give a nasal spray, and it's got it's really simple so that people can just put it together rapidly, even if they're missing the inside there with the Save Me, how to put the kit together. Remember that naloxone only lasts for 30 to 90 minutes. So you're going to need to tell the client that or the patient when they wake up if you've used it. They've been thrown right into withdrawals, and they may want to run out and get high right away because of how bad they feel, but they need to be educated that if they use again, it's probably going to cause an overdose, or their overdose can return, especially if they're on fentanyl or if they've taken pills that haven't all dissolved yet. The effects of opioids can really last a long time, longer than the effects of naloxone. Remember, someone should always remain with the person until 911 help arrives, and you should never relinquish anyone to someone unless they have greater or equal training to you. Be ready to give the EMTs and paramedics information about how much of the naloxone you've given and how the timing between the doses and the effects that you saw. Remember, if there is a change, you know that opiates may have been part of it. If you don't see any change, then you know that it's probably something else that's going on. Remember the Save Me protocol. Stimulation, you're going to try to wake them up. If they don't respond, you first call to them. And if that doesn't work, you reach over and gently shake them. If that doesn't work, then you do painful stimulus without injuring them. Once again, rubbing your knuckle on the sternum, the upper lip, or behind the arm. in the airway. Once again, make sure that nothing is blocking the airway. Tilt the head back. Look to see if there's anything in there. If it's easy for you to reach in and take it out, go ahead, but never do a blind sweep. If they need rescue breathing, remember it's one breath every 5 seconds for 12 breaths, and then you're going to reevaluate. Are they any better? Excuse me. Can you get to the naloxone? Remember, you only have 6 minutes if they're not breathing to get the kit. If you can't get to the kit in time, then you need to call for help and continue your rescue breathing until help arrives. The mist, you need to prepare it if it's once you get it. Like I say, if you have kits and you hear an emergency call, you may want to consider just running and getting it and running to the emergency if you have a plan in place. Prepare the naloxone. It's really quick to put the kit together. And then go back to their rescue breathing after you give the naloxone. And remember, you're monitoring every minute to see if the naloxone is working. Evaluate and support once again. Are they breathing on their own? If it doesn't kick in, give a second dose. Remember that people are going to be very agitated after this. So it's going to be good for you to stay there. They recommend that during the whole process, you actually speak to the client, even if they appear unconscious. A lot of people, when they come through and are awake again, say that they were able to hear some of what their rescuer was saying, and it comforted them and calmed them down. So one of the things we want to do is talk throughout the process. What if you want to start your own program? One of the things you're going to need to do is look at the scope of the overdose problem in your community or treatment center. Do you see a lot of it, and what drugs are they overdosing on? Who's overdosing, and where are they? You're going to need a medical director, a licensed physician who's willing to prescribe naloxone. Different states have different rules. So as I mentioned earlier in the training, you can look them up and see what they are in your state. To purchase naloxone, most states actually require a prescription. There are some states now, especially Rhode Island, where they're actually allowing people to get naloxone, even if in that area a blanket standing order is set. And so they've had agreements with CVS and Walgreens to provide naloxone to people who are coming in and train them. Not all states are that liberal, but it's the laws are changing throughout the country. In Illinois, you can't do that, but you can in Rhode Island, and I think New Mexico is also beginning to go that route. Look at your agency. See what your agency facilities are, your policies. Do you need to write a new policy for this and the staff? Are there any barriers to this? If you're using the injection method, is your staff able to actually provide an injection even though they're not medical personnel? A lot of people, lay people, have been trained with the injection method and it's been successful. You can go on the Chicago Recovery Alliance site and it actually has a short video there you can watch that will show you the whole process of doing the injection method or the intramuscular method of giving naloxone. And then what resources do you already have? Do you have all the things you need to provide training, to provide all the supplies that they need? One thing you need to know is that this is not very expensive unless you use the Invisio, which is several hundred dollars. Most of the kits I've seen for nasal or IM injection are between $30 and $40. And this is for a whole kit. They give you both the mister and the syringe and the vial, the naloxone, and the gloves, all you supplies, the breathing mask and the box to put them in. You need to pick a place that's easily accessible. A lot of places put the overdose kit next to their emergency kit, and so that everyone knows where it is. It's really important that you probably have regular refreshers so that you remember what to do, and also refreshers if you have the training apparatus directly there for people to take it apart and put it together. Otherwise, people are going to forget. And when the emergency does arise, they may not have the memory of what they should be doing. That's a good reason why whatever instructions you put in your overdose kit should be very simple and laid out frequently with pictures so so that people can just look at it and remember what they're supposed to do. You need to know that overdose is really killing thousands of Americans every year. And a lot of it is due to medications. One of the things they've discovered is that prescription drug abuse has really increased dramatically. If you'll remember, or you may not know, back in the 80s, when physicians were treating pain, they didn't do a very good job of it frequently, if somebody, even if they were terminally ill. The doctors wouldn't prescribe enough medication to manage their pain because they were afraid of them becoming addicted. When it was Jayco came out with saying, you need to treat pain better. So if you'll remember, and a lot of you may have seen the faces where it goes from really sad and painful looking to a face that a person feels normal, and they ask them to assess their pain level. What happened during that period is physicians began to start prescribing all types of opioids to manage people's pain. Some people didn't take it all. They left it in their medicine cabinet and got confounded. A lot of times either other family members, neighbors, or their children found it, became addicted, and then they discovered that after they couldn't get any more, that when they went on the street, the pills are actually very expensive. A Vicodin pill can go for $30 or $40 in some areas. So they discovered that heroin actually is cheaper than getting a pharmaceutical drug, so a lot of people switched to heroin. And remember, the dangers of that is you don't know what you're injecting, because the dealer frequently cuts it with other drugs that may be stronger or weaker. With naloxone and proper education, a lot of this can be prevented. So, and that's why the states are changing the laws. One of our goals is to become educated enough to where we don't have these. As I said before, we've trained like 222 people, and this has been very effective. The staff has received it well. We really haven't had resistance to this. There is, you'll have to know if you look this up, some controversy about this. There are some people who believe that having naloxone will actually increase people risk behavior because they know they can be rescued. As far as I know in my research, this has not occurred. So we need to, I think, all of us take a look at it and, if possible, influence people to get their own programs started and to become educated on this. You know, a lot of the states now and different counties in each state are recognizing the problems with overdose, and so they're able to manage and set up a program. And that's not expensive to do, so it's something that we can go ahead and think about. I've reached the end of my part of the presentation. If you haven't already, type in some questions, and then I can answer them for you. I just wanted to mention one thing about CPR. When you're first taught CPR, a lot of times now they talk about not giving the breath. And this is different when you suspect an opiate overdose. So now they're teaching you just do compression. But if you suspect overdose, then you're going to look to breathing as well. They still do have breathing by healthcare professionals, but frequently now they're teaching lay people just to do the compression. But like I said, if you're trained in overdose management, you can also do the breaths. So any more questions, you can please type them in now.
Okay, Carl, get to those. First, thanks for the presentation, another outstanding job. A couple of things. There's probably some people that need to jump off due to time constraints, so if that is the case for you, if you would please take a moment and fill out the brief survey. Your feedback is definitely important to us, and it helps us develop future webinars. And also a couple of reminders. First, be on the lookout for an email, as we said earlier, that will include a link to the presentation for your future reference. And also, you should be receiving your CEU's certificate within the next 3 weeks. If you're going to stay with us, we'll take a few minutes to look at the questions. And again, if you could, if you have something you'd like to ask, please submit it. We have a few that we can address real quickly here while we have time, Carl.
The first one is actually from Lisa, and she has asked, during a recent CPR class, I was told that rescue breathing is not normally done anymore. Is this something that should be done in the case of opioid OD as opposed to general standards?
Yeah, it's recommended if you suspect an overdose and their heart's still beating that you go ahead and give rescue breath. If you come upon them and they don't have a pulse, then you immediately go into CPR the way that you've been trained. But yes, it is a little different if you suspect opioid overdose.
Okay, next question is from Alexis, and she says, hold on just a second here, is naltrexone just a longer-term use of naloxone?
Yes, naltrexone lasts longer in the body, and so it lasts for several hours. It's not really suitable for treating overdose because it's not rapid enough. So naloxone is a drug that's used for treating overdose. Naltrexone is often used for when people are leaving treatment, and it prevents them from getting high when they're out and helps reduce their risk of using.
Okay, the next question is from Paula, and she asks, does Gateway treat patients who are addicted to opioids with detox, or do they have to be detoxed medically first?
Sometimes, if a person is relatively stable, they might bring people on if they've already been prescribed something. And they'll bring them in on that. Most of the time, though, they're going to have them go out and be detoxed before they come to Gateway. But if they're already on Suboxone, they'll bring them in on it. And we'll continue to give it to them and taper them off or however the psychiatrist or physician determines what they need.
Okay, next question is from Patricia. And she asked, have you heard about pain management doctors using other means versus pain pills, stimulators or pumps?
Yeah. They oftentimes, doctors will use acupuncture. Sometimes they'll use other methods to manage pain. I'm not familiar with all the pain management techniques that are available now, but I know that for some people they rotate opioids. But they do have other methods, as well as psychological counseling, to help a person manage chronic pain.
Okay, and it looks like Dawn has a clarification question, and it was questioning, after 90 minutes cold, the OD without using more opiates.
What I meant is, if they take opiates in, and they've taken a large amount of opiates, the naloxone is going to be wearing off after 30 to 90 minutes. So if it's still in their body, the drug is going to take effect again, depending on the dosage, whether or not it suppresses their breathing. That would be the determining factor, is the dosage that they took. I hope that clarifies that for you.
Okay, it looks like we have one final question from Clifton. And that question is, what was the cost again for the kit that has nasal attachments?
The cheapest price that I've come across is $28.50 per kit. That's not including the mask or the box. So you're going to see kits within that range between $30 and $40.
Okay, well, that's all of our questions. Hold on, we have one more that just came in, and it's... from Ellie, and she asks, can you tell us again where the survey, well, that's actually a technical question, so we'll have Nicole send that response. And then that is our last question. So with that, we're going to go ahead and conclude the webinar. Thank you once again, Carl, for a great job, and thank you all for attending. Be on the lookout for, again, your CEU certificate and the link for the presentation. And also be on the lookout for webinars we will be presenting in the future. So we thank you once again, and everybody have a great afternoon.